Learning objectives of today's lecture. We'll be first dealing with biosynthesis and degradation of collagen, and then we'll be taking into account collagenopathies, which are the disorders associated with collagen. So two important disorders we'll be looking into. First is Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and the second one is osteogenesis imperfecta. Biosynthesis of collagen. Precursors of the collagen molecule are first prepared in fibroblasts, for example, osteoblasts of bone and chondroblasts of cartilage. Then these are secreted into the extracellular matrix. In the extracellular matrix, collagen monomers that have been matured get aggregated in the presence of enzymes. And lastly, aggregated mature collagen monomers undergo cross-linkage, and as a result of which, collagen fibers are finally formed. So the general steps that are involved in the biosynthesis of collagen are, first, proalpha chains are formed, then there is process of hydroxylation, then there is glycosylation, afterwards assemblage and secretion take place, then there is cleavage of procollagen molecules in extracellular matrix. Then there is formation of collagen fibrils. And lastly, there is cross-link formation for the synthesis of mature collagen fibers. Now we're going to see detailed explanation of the steps involved in the synthesis of collagen molecule. First of all, genes that carry information for making proalpha 1 and proalpha 2 chains of collagen are transcribed into messenger RNA from DNA. This messenger RNA goes to rough endoplasmic reticulum, where it is translated into pre-proalpha polypeptide chains. Pre-proalpha polypeptide chains contain signal sequence. Now, what is signal sequence? Signal sequence is a sequence of amino acids which is attached at the end terminus of polypeptide chain. There are two termini of polypeptide chain. One is C terminus, another is N terminus. N stands for amino group, and C stands for carboxylic acid group. So pre-proalpha polypeptide chains, when are formed, are then sent into the lumen of the rough endoplasmic reticulum. Now, in the lumen of the rough endoplasmic reticulum, their signal sequence is removed. And once the signal sequence is removed, pre-proalpha polypeptide chain is converted into proalpha chain. So this chain, which is shown in pink color here, is the proalpha chain that has been formed from pre-proalpha polypeptide chain after the removal of signal sequence at the N-terminal end of polypeptide chain. Now, this proalpha chain is now going to be converted into mature collagen fibers. For example, first, what is going to happen here? That selected proline and lysine residues of proalpha chain are going to be hydroxylated. In the previous lecture, we have seen the process of hydroxylation. For example, you can see here that proline amino acid of proalpha chain is hydroxylated to hydroxyproline or hydroxyprolyl amino acid or residue with the help of prolyl hydroxylase enzyme. In this step, oxygen is used, then alpha-ketoglutarate, ascorbate or vitamin C or iron are used as cofactors, water is released, and succinate and carbon dioxide are also formed. And this proline residue becomes hydroxylated here, and you can get hydroxyprolyl residue. If you have to hydroxylate lysine residue into hydroxylysine, then in place of prolyl hydroxylase, lysyl hydroxylase enzyme is used. So if there is lysine residue of collagen chain, then it is converted into hydroxylysine with the help of lysyl hydroxylase enzyme. Ascorbic acid or vitamin C plays important role in the hydroxylation step for the synthesis of collagen. If ascorbic acid or vitamin C is deficient, then hydroxylation of lysine and proline residues of collagen chains cannot be done. As a result of which, hydrogen bond formation between chains of collagens would be impaired. Stable triple helix of collagen cannot be formed. Collagen fibers cannot be cross-linked properly, and as a result of which strength of the collagen fiber that would be assembled, it would be greatly decreased. So this deficiency may result into a disease which is called as scurvy. After hydroxylation of proline and lysine residues of pro-alpha chains of collagen, there is the process of glycosylation. Selected hydroxylysine residues become glycosylated with glucose and galactose. Here you can see, here glucose is attached and here galactose is attached. Now, after this process, three pro-alpha chains assemble. Here you can see three alpha pro chains are going to be assembled. Now what happens here, intrachain and interchain disulfide bonds are formed at the C terminus. So this is the C terminus and this is the N terminus. C is for the carboxylic acid containing group. So at the C terminus of these three pro-alpha chains, there is the formation of disulfide bond in between the chains, which is called interchain bonding. And there is also intrachain disulfide bonding, which means within the chain. Now the same disulfide bonding interchain and intrachain takes place at the N terminus as well, and a triple helix of collagen is formed, which is called as procollagen. So this is procollagen structure. Now this procollagen is then sent to Golgi apparatus, where it is converted into secretory vesicles. So the procollagen molecule from the Golgi vacuole is secreted into the extracellular matrix. Now in the extracellular matrix, there is the removal of the termini. For example, this C terminus is removed and this N terminus is removed. This is also called extracellular cleavage of procollagen molecules. Now the C terminus and the N terminus are removed with the help of procollagen peptidases, and procollagen is converted into now tropocollagen. So only this structure, which is in between the termini, is called as tropocollagen. Now this tropocollagen undergoes self-assemblage into fibrils with the process of cross-linking. So here you can see that one chain of tropocollagen is going to be cross-linked with another tropocollagen, and as a result of which mature collagen fibers are formed. Now we are going to see the process of cross-linkage in detail. So how one chain of tropocollagen becomes associated with another chain of tropocollagen, and this is done with the help of cross-link formation. So what happens first? One of the chains of tropocollagen exposes its lysine residue. This lysine residue is converted into a lysine residue with the help of lysyl oxidase. Now what is a lysine residue? A lysine residue is the aldehyde form of the lysine residue. In this process, oxygen is used and copper is used. Ammonia and water are released, and this end of the lysine residue is converted into a lysine residue, lysine residue is the aldehyde form of lysine. So one chain of the tropocollagen converts its lysine residue into lysine residue. Now this lysine residue becomes linked with the lysine residue of another tropocollagen chain. And here you can see that this bond is formed. So as a result of which, one tropocollagen chain becomes cross-linked with another chain of tropocollagen and mature collagen fiber is formed. Now we are going to see the process of degradation of collagen. Normally, collagen is highly stable and it is not degradable. And it can live as long as many years. But you see that connective tissue that contains collagen is dynamic, which means that it can undergo changes. So there is constant modeling and remodeling of connective tissue involving collagen molecule. So whenever there is growth period or there is injury or damage imparted to the tissue, collagen molecules can undergo modeling and remodeling. There is one special class of enzymes that can degrade collagen, and this is simply called as collagenase or collagenases. This class basically is a part of matrix metalloproteinase or MMP. So this collagenase enzyme, it can convert collagen first into smaller fragments. And then these smaller fragments are converted finally into amino acids using matrix proteinases enzyme. So you have to memorize the names of two important enzymes for degrading collagen. First is collagenase and the second one is matrix proteinase. Collagenase converts collagen into smaller fragments, and then the smaller fragments are converted into individual amino acids using matrix proteinases. Now, collagen degradation, it can be increased when you are starving or whenever there is inflammation in the body. Next part of today's lecture is to study collagen-associated disorders or diseases. These are also called as collagenopathies. If the synthesis of collagen fiber is defective, then it may result into a number of genetic disorders. More than 1,000 mutations have been observed in around 23 genes which code for 13 types of collagen. Mutant chains of collagen may show altered behaviors. For example, their structure may be different, their mode of secretion may become different, or their distribution in tissues or organs may also vary. And mostly, collagen mutant chains undergo degradation. Now we are going to study in detail two important collagenopathies. Number first is Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, which is abbreviated as EDS, and the second one is osteogenesis imperfecta or OI. Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. This belongs to generalized connective tissue disorders. It arises from genetic defects in the metabolism of collagen molecules that are of fibrillar type. Ehlers-Danlos syndrome can result or can be caused by defective synthesis of lysyl hydroxylase or procollagen peptidase, which are collagen processing enzymes. It can also result from mutations in the amino acid sequence of different collagen types, for example, type 1 collagen, type 3, and type 5 collagen. Clinically important mutations are seen in the type 3 collagen gene, and this is also called as vascular form, and this is also considered as the most serious type of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Collagen that belongs to type 3 is a key component of the arteries. So if collagen type 3 is defective, then it may result into life-threatening vascular problems. For example, it may result into arterial rupture or arterial damage. Mutant or defective chains of collagen cannot be properly secreted, even they can't be fully or easily degraded, or they can be accumulated up to high levels in the different compartments of the cell. Defects or abnormalities in collagen type 5 can result into one of the important forms of EDS, which is called as classic form of EDS. Patients of classic form of EDS may show fragile and stretchy skin and also loose joints. Second type of collagenopathy we are going to study is osteogenesis imperfecta. This also belongs to heterogeneous group of genetic diseases. This is also called as brittle bone disease. And the marked feature of osteogenesis imperfecta is bone fragility, that bones become fragile. These can easily be damaged or these can easily be broken down. Now, what are the causes of osteogenesis imperfecta? In around 80% of the osteogenesis imperfecta cases, mutations are seen in the genes that code for alpha 1 and alpha 2 chains belonging to type 1 collagen. And the most common mutation is the amino acid substitution, in which there is replacement of the glycine in the sequence GlyXY by those amino acids that contain bulky side chains. As a result of which, stable triple helix of collagen cannot be formed. Now, severity of this disease, it range from mild to lethal or life-threatening. Now, we are going to see type 1 osteogenesis imperfecta. Type 1 osteogenesis imperfecta is also termed as osteogenesis imperfecta tarda. This is considered as the most commonest form of OI. And the clinical features of this disease are mild bone fragility, loss of hearing, and blue sclera. Osteogenesis imperfecta type 2 is also called osteogenesis imperfecta congenita. This is also considered as the most severest form of osteogenesis imperfecta. It is mostly life-threatening because it may result into pulmonary complications, as it can cause pulmonary hypoplasia, that is the incomplete development of lungs, in which the size of the lungs may be abnormal in the uterus of the mother or even in the newborns. Even fractures can be seen in the uterus. In type 2 osteogenesis imperfecta, which is the lethal form or life-threatening form, you can easily observe fractures which are appearing in the developing baby in the uterus before birth. Type 3 osteogenesis imperfecta is also considered as a severe form of osteogenesis imperfecta. Clinical traits of this disorder include multiple fractures at birth, then short stature or short height of individuals, often characterized by short limbs of patients, then spinal curvature that may lead to further camel back or humped back appearance, which is also called as kyphosis. As you can see here, that curved spine is called as kyphosis. And the common feature of type 3 osteogenesis imperfecta is blue sclera. In all the types of osteogenesis imperfecta, dentinogenesis imperfecta may also be seen, which is an abnormal development of tooth.